Good day, YouTubers, and welcome to yet another episode of the Northern Moreton Bay series. Once again, this video is being uploaded ahead of my anticipated schedule, courtesy of bad weather. If I can't be out fishing, I may as well make a video about fishing. In this episode, I'm going to finish off the Pearl Channel, talking about things I'd look for if I was over there prospecting for new spots to fish. That'll take up about half the video. For the other half of the video, we'll move over towards Bribie and look at some spots where you can actually fish. There's a lot of history surrounding Bribie. I'm not going to get to talk about much of it this episode in the time limit. I'll try and get something in. I'll try and get a little bit in the next episode, see how we go. Anyway, enough talking. Let's get on with it. Starting from where I left off last time in the Pearl Channel, you'll notice there's a few more marks up than I showed in the previous video. I had left them out thinking that I wouldn't have time to get to them, but since I had to split this video into two parts, I'll put the rest of them up there now and we'll talk about them all, bar the ones I've already discussed. I said I was going to work down the west side of the Pearl Channel, but since I'm doing the second video and I've added some more marks, it makes more sense to work from north to south. Fortunately, that's what we started doing, so we'll swap over to the east side of the channel now and have a look at a rather interesting drop-off there. The drop-off that I'm interested in is just off the main part of the Pearl Channel, but according to the maps, there's plenty of water to get into there and have a look at the drop-off. If in doubt, come in directly from the west and you've got oodles of water there. It shouldn't get to be less than about 8 or 9 metres. Calling it a drop-off is a bit misleading. It's only about a 1 in 10 slope. It's not the vertical drop-off that I'm really interested in. It's the potential for some rough ground there, maybe some rubble patches or something else similar, something that'll hold bait. So I'd be looking at this on the side scanner and also on the down imaging, trying to get a feel for what the bottom is like. Still on the east side of the channel, there's a couple more spots here that I would have a look at, and that is where the contour lines come in very tight together. They're still not vertical drops or anything, they're steeper slopes than the surroundings, and the reason I'd look at them is just that, they're steeper slopes than the surroundings. It could just be the way the current goes swirling around that area. It could also be that it's a harder structure on the bottom there, and that could mean there's some contours or structure there that would attract fish. So again, a couple of spots where I would have a scan around and see what was on the bottom. Also keep in mind when you're scanning around for these things, you're looking for structure, not fish. You might be there at the wrong time for the fish. You don't know what tide this is going to fish. Even if there's structure there, it might be that the fish only come on the slack tide or the incoming tide, the outgoing tide. But the first thing you need to do is establish whether the structure's there for the fish and then keep going back until you find when the fish gather there. I put this mark in not so much for the fishing or looking for fish or structure, but because I was thinking if I was up in that area for a few hours looking for structure and that was my main goal, it wouldn't hurt to take a couple of crab pots, and I think if I was in that area spending a couple of hours, I would drop those crab pots in that inlet, for want of a better word, come back and pick them up after I'd finished checking out the rest of the Pearl Channel. I don't know that there's crabs there. I know there's a lot of crabs up in these sandbanks in that part of the bay, but this area just struck me as worthwhile to have a bit of a prospect in. The map shows the current there is 1.5 knots. Now that is a lot of current. You don't want to go dropping light crab pots there, you want the heavy duty crab pots. Or if all you've got is light crab pots, put a brick or two in them. Otherwise you'll come back and find they're just not there. But anyway, for what it's worth, if you like crabs and you are planning to go and prospect around the Pearl Channel, there's a thought for you. Here's another area that I'd have a look at in detail on the sounder. The only thing that's drawing my attention to these areas is the fact that the contour lines become closer together, and that indicates that the bottom might be a little bit harder in that area and therefore harder for the current to wash away, which results in a steeper slope. As you can see from the contour lines and the depth that I've put in here, the drop-off on the eastern side appears to be a lot steeper than the drop-off on the western side. However, that's not the case. When you compare the distance that it takes to drop down with the amount of drop there is, it turns out that both sides have approximately a 1 in 5 slope on them. Not a great deal. A 1 in 5 slope amounts to about 11 degrees, if you can visualise 11 degrees of angle. So it's not much of a slope, but it's just enough to say, well, maybe that's a sort of harder area there. And if it's a harder area there, it's likely to have little washouts. And I'll show you a small video of just the sort of thing I'm meaning. Just something to create some structure for the fish to hang around. Anyway, that's what I'm looking for by doing this. And you spend a lot of time going around looking at these things. I might spend a whole day out there and find nothing. But unless you look, then you're limited to the places that everyone else knows about. This is some footage that I have from elsewhere in the bay. It's actually some footage from down around Ormston area. It shows the bottom structure that I'm looking for and how the currents can scoop out the softer sand and leave the harder material behind. The end result is some structure that the fish can get around. Bait fish will congregate there, the big fish will know about it, they'll come in and eat the bait fish. If you can find that and then figure out how the tides work in that area to attract the fish, or at least what part of the tides the fish are likely to be there, then you've got a good fishing spot. If you're like me and you just enjoy being out there looking for spots as much as you like fishing, then consider giving some of your spots away once you have a few. On the other hand, if you've got one that you bag out on every time you go there, keep that one to yourself. This next one is an exercise in optimism, even by my standards. The top mark there is a public mark, which I spoke about in the previous video in this series. The bottom mark is the one that I want to have a look at, and the only reason I want to have a look at it is there's a depression there, which indicates some soft area. If you've paid attention to some of the talk that's been on the internet for the last few years, I guess, they talk about sinkholes and wonky holes on the ocean floor being places where fish congregate. So any depression I come across or see on the Navionics maps that's sort of a localised depression, I go and have a look at it because I've never found one. I don't know what they look like, to be honest. I figure there's got to be some sort of depression on the ocean floor, so anything I see, I go and have a look at it just to see if I'll get lucky one day and find one. So you can take this mark with a grain of salt. It's a long shot. As a final suggestion for the Pearl Channel is the southwest spit down the very bottom of it. Although it's underwater, it does indeed look like a spit of land. So any spit of land, have a look around both sides of it and have a look off the end of it. As with all these suggestions, no guarantee there'll be anything there, but they're all spots where there's a good possibility that you might find something. Now just before we leave the Pearl Channel and carry on across the bay, I'll just leave you with this bathymetric shot of the area. It's very interesting. If you're looking for new spots, this is the sort of thing you need to get your hands on. I find it's pretty good in the bay, but it's really just invaluable when you get offshore. I'll talk more about that when we start to do the offshore series in probably a few months. Finally, we've made it over to the southern end of Bribie Island. This is an area that I haven't fished at all from a boat. I have been through the area when I used to launch out of Bribie and take Dancer over past the top end of Moreton. I probably sounded some of the spots on my way out to Moreton, but the sounders we had in those days were not a patch on what we have today. I can't remember anything standing out as remarkable. However, I have come across these marks over the years and collected them with the idea that one day I might get up there to use them, which seems a remote possibility now because I have so many other places that I'd like to go. I'll just start this off with a little bit of trivia. Those of you that are old enough to remember the TV show Gilligan's Island, which ran for years and years about some castaways that were on an island and never got off, well, if you didn't know it, we have our very own Gilligan's Island right here, and that flag is on it. Although I think any castaway there would be found fairly quickly. I did define an arbitrary line between Skirmish Point and Combiore Point as being the northern boundary of the area that I would talk about, but I'm going to go outside that again just to talk about a couple of marks that I have here that don't fit into any of the future videos I have in mind, so we'll get them out of the way first of all. The first of those marks is the Dana Marie, which is a sailing catch that was wrecked there on November 25th, 1965. The mark itself is approximate because, as far as I could find out, no one has ever precisely located the wreck. At least if anyone has located it, it's a well-kept secret. And I guess any decent wreck is usually a good fishing spot, and if someone does know about it, that's probably why they're keeping it a secret. So that's the approximate area if you want to go and have a search for yourself. Here's one I picked up off the internet at some stage. I can't remember exactly where I picked it up. The only notation I have on it is try here question mark. So something I've just seen on one of the forums probably and put down, never been to. Like buying a pig in a poke. If you want to give it a go, have a look and see if there's anything there. Now this is one I've been told about by a few people as Skirmish Ledge or the ledge off Skirmish Point. They didn't actually give me a mark for it, but I did find these marks that seem to fit the area that I've been told about. It's supposedly a pretty good fishing spot, so if I've got the marks right, they would be worth a go. Of course, since the people that told me didn't give me the marks, there's also the possibility that I haven't quite got them right, but they do seem to fit what I was told. And just while we're near Skirmish Point, interesting story about how Skirmish Point got its name. Apparently, when Flinders came along to explore Moreton Bay after Cook, he landed at Skirmish Point, which apparently at the time he thought was part of the mainland. And he met a group of natives down on the beach. They were reasonably friendly, except for one fellow. About the time they were going to leave, he decided that he wanted Flinders' hat, and there was a bit of a scuffle over it. Flinders didn't want to give it up. After the scuffle, the group retreated to the boat and started to leave. The native really took offence and threw a spear at them, whereupon Flinders returned fire and apparently wounded the native. After that, the area was named Skirmish Point. These are the balance of the marks that I have in this area. I'm not going to list the GPS coordinates in one screen as I've done in the past. I'm going to break this up and talk about groups of these. Although I haven't fished them, I have gathered some information about these groups, which will probably help anyone who does decide to give them a go. Or at least I hope it will. For these first three marks here, I've got a note against them that Internet FF, which means Internet Fishing Forum. I've picked them up on a forum. The usual case there is that someone asks for some marks and then someone else says, here, try these marks. The marks may or may not be any good. I haven't been to them myself. I just haven't got around to it yet, even though I've had them for several years by the looks of it. It's been many, many years now since I've had a boat anywhere near that area, and even back then I didn't fish the southern end of Bribie, so I can't comment on any of these marks here personally. But these three were published on a public forum, so I'm sharing them here with you. If you're going past, you can have a look and see if there's anything worthwhile there. I was told about this next one quite a few years ago now. Many years ago now. It's a reef off Skirmish Point, apparently. I've never fished it. As I've said, I haven't fished this area. But I was told that this reef off Skirmish Point produces well. I should go and try it. I never did get around to it, never did find it, and never did have any GPS marks for it, just a rough position of how to find it. But I came across these marks on the internet, I think, came across them somewhere anyway, that purport to be Skirmish Reef. So I'm guessing they're the same spot I was told about all those years ago. They're in the vicinity that was described to me anyway. If you want to go and give it a go, have a look for a reef in that area, see what the fish are like. For this next one, there's a deeper channel that runs along part of the southern end of Bribie. It's at least 7 or 8 metres deep, and there are some holes that get a bit deeper. This is one of those holes. I'll put the marks up here of where the channel runs from east to west. It's not a straight channel. You'll have to follow the depth contour on your sounder. But if you sound along that, you'll find some deeper holes. There's a mark here for one of them. You can go straight to the mark and have a look there if you want to. Or sound along that channel and see what else you can find. This mark was a public mark that I picked up somewhere or other, but it definitely marks a deep hole there. The hole itself should be at least 10 metres deep, depending on the tide. And just a word of warning about going into that channel, there is a sandbank in front of it. According to the bathymetry, there's at least 2 metres of water over the sandbank, even at low tide. But the bathymetry on the map can always be wrong. There can always be an isolated shallow area, so just use appropriate caution if you're going into there. This one's another hole in a channel, and this is a channel that leads out of Punniston Passage down around the southern end of Bribie. It's only slightly deeper, a bit of a shallow depression in the channel. It goes down an extra metre or so, and it's not very steep along the axis of the channel. However, there's quite a drop-off in towards Bribie, and that's a bit that I'd be interested in, is fishing along that drop-off towards Bribie from that spot. Have a sound around, see what the bottom's like. I could be quite wrong about this. As I say, not the spot I have fished, but just looking at the bathymetry in the area, I would be looking at fishing that drop-off along Bribie. Could be some rubble on the bottom, though, further out. So don't just go there and fish without having a sound around, just to see what the area's like. This video is getting long enough now, so I'm going to cut it off shortly. This final point here is one where I've been told you get whiting. I've not been given the GPS mark itself, but I've been given the area, and this is another public mark which matches the area that I've been told about on that sandbank. It's around about 2 metres deep in that area, and you drift along the sandbank edge. Whether this is a good spot to go depends on your direction of drift. There's a lot of sandbanks around, a lot more marks to come where you'll get whiting. And just depends which way the wind's blowing, which way your boat's going to drift, which one you want to fish on. That's assuming you're in a whiting season, which is pretty much all year. But although you can catch either summer or winter whiting all year, just remember they do move around, and just because you caught them on one bank last week doesn't mean you'll catch them on the same bank this week. The problem with fish is that they have a brain, and having a brain gives them the ability to make a choice. And sometimes they choose not to be in the spot where we expect to find them. Well, that's it for this video. I'll cover the balance of the marks that I've had on screen in the next video. And I'm going to put some history from Bribie Island in that video as well. There's quite a lot of really fascinating history there. So I'll try to cover all that in the next video before we move down to the Redcliffe area. Thanks for taking the time to watch it. Hope you got something out of it. Until next time, good fishing.